address a misunderstanding that occurred in the last session. There was one question, a last question, that was not answered due to acoustic problems, a question on the critique of Zionism and accusations of anti-Semitism, and this question will be addressed in our discussion round at the end of our three presentations here. So sorry for that misunderstanding. The speakers just didn't understand the question. But without further delay, we'd like to start our second panel on securitization and sexualization. My name is Zakariya Keskinkiliç. I am lecturer and research fellow at the Alice Salomon University of Applied Sciences here in Berlin. And I'm happy to co-chair this panel together with Saboura, Manpreet, Naqshband, who is activist and co-founder of the intersectional group Berlin Muslim Feminists. At this panel, we draw on the theoretical discussions we had in the previous session on processes of racialization and pave the way to the third panel, which later will be on counter strategies. So at this point, we are interested in how far Islamophobia manifests itself specifically in the contemporary phenomenon of securitization, which means processes that create Muslims and those who are perceived as Muslims as a threat to our Western nations and values, including tropes of Islamization, infiltration, as well as accusations of disloyalty. Tropes that are not necessarily new, but can be traced back to the early beginnings of Islamophobia as a racialized discourse and practice in the 15th century in Spain after the so-called Reconquista, when Muslims, side to side with Jews actually, and those who were perceived and classified as Muslims and Jews, were portrayed as an alien, dangerous element that needs to be observed, controlled, and expelled based on the idea of the purity of blood. This figure of the radical, extremist, backward, and dangerous Muslim intersects with other social categories, such as notions of gender and sexuality, and fundamentally affects Muslims and those perceived as Muslims in their everyday life. This is what we want to address with our speakers who came all the way from the US and Canada. Please join me in welcoming Jasmin Zine from Wilfrid, Laurier University in Canada, Usma Jamil from McGill University in Canada, and last but not least, Moustafa Bayoumi from City University of New York. We're going to, we are going to present each speaker in much more detail ahead of their talk. Each person has up to 50 minutes, and we are going to open the floor for discussion after we had all 3 minutes. You have, okay, and people told us to remind you that you should speak more slowly and clearly so that they can understand your lecture. And so let us first start with Moustafa Bayoumi, professor of English at Brooklyn College, City University of New York. He is the author of the critically acclaimed How Does It Feel to Be a Problem? Being Young and Arab in America, which won an American Book Award and the Arab American Book Award for Nonfiction. His latest book, This Muslim American Life, Dispatches from the War on Terror, was chosen as a best book of 2015 by the Progressive magazine and was also awarded the Arab American Book Award for Nonfiction. Bayoumi is also a columnist for The Guardian, and his writing has appeared in the New York Times magazine, The Daily Beast, The Nation, The London Review of Books, The National, and many other places. He has been featured in the Wall Street Journal, the Chicago Sun-Times, Fox News, National Public Radio, and many other media outlets from around the world. Please join me in welcoming Moustafa Bayoumi.
Thank you, thank you. Can everyone hear me okay? Yes? Okay, well, what an honor and a pleasure it is to speak to you today. First of all, I would very much like to thank the organizers for this auspicious and important conference. And of course, the location is very meaningful in all kinds of ways, as I'm sure everyone is well aware. And it's also just one of the most beautiful places I've actually given a lecture in, so thank you for that, too. I hope I don't go over time. I'm just gonna start right into my talk. I will say, though, that I am talking specifically about the U.S. context, and I think it's very important that we understand the different national contexts for what we're talking about, and to understand both their similarities but also their differences. My fear sometimes when we're discussing issues around Islamophobia is that they collapse, the differences between the states get collapsed, and there are very specific reasons, local reasons, why certain movements of power actually appear. And so I think that the understanding the differences and the similarities are very important. Yes. I will. In August 2001, the Associated Press began publishing a chilling series of reports that detailed a covert program undertaken by the New York City Police Department, the NYPD, to spy on Muslims in the tri-state area of New York, New Jersey, and Connecticut. As made abundantly clear by the reports, the NYPD was not chasing specific leads or even basing their investigations on probable cause, the customary legal standard for beginning an inquiry. Quite the contrary, working with officials on loan from the Central Intelligence Agency, the CIA, the NYPD was instead cataloging every element of Muslim American life, from the stores they shopped in to where they got their haircuts, and noting what patrons, inscribing the license plates of congregants, where they got their haircuts. The NYPD was spying on mosques and coffee shops, inscribing the license plates of congregants and noting what patrons were saying. The police department had set up sports leagues for young Muslims, ostensibly as community outreach efforts, and then used the same sports leagues to spy on the same young Muslims. And the department also placed confidential informants in at least 7 different Muslim student associations, MSAs, found on college campuses. One document leaked to the press showed that the NYPD had labeled 2 MSAs as of concern. One of them was at Brooklyn College, where I teach. And the report further listed 42 top-tier persons of interest, which included a lecturer at Brooklyn College. Many people assumed that this lecturer must be me. Frankly, I wondered the same, while also thinking it would be absurd for the police to waste their resources on me. However troubling all this information was, Muslim community members, both on campus and off, were not surprised by the reports. I, for one, had been hearing similar suspicions of blanket surveillance for many years. To us, the Associated Press reports were a confirmation rather than a revelation. Hard evidence of something we had long suspected to be true. The team of reporters who covered the story for the Associated Press eventually won a Pulitzer Prize for their efforts. Activists pushed back against the NYPD programs, and the city ultimately created a new position, an inspector general to oversee the actions of the police. After a new mayor, Bill de Blasio, was elected and installed in New York, the people of the city were told that the specific unit of the police department that had been directly involved in the surveillance, unassumingly called the Demographics Unit, had officially been disbanded. In April 2014, de Blasio called the changes, quote, a critical step forward in easing tensions between the police and the communities they serve, so that our cops and our citizens can help one another go after the real bad guys. So imagine our reaction when, a year later, Muslim students at Brooklyn College learned that an undercover police officer had been actively spying on them and their legally protected activities for approximately 4 years, from 2011 to 2015, well after the mayor's official notice declaring an end to such practices.
The discovery came following a terrorism-related arrest of two women in Queens who were unconnected with Brooklyn College and its Muslim student organization. An undercover officer of the NYPD had been directly involved in that arrest, and it didn't take long for the students at the college to realize that this officer was no other than Melika, or Mel, a woman who had been hanging around and befriending a host of Muslim women students at Brooklyn College's Islamic Society Organization, or ISO. Mel, who had appeared to be in her 20s, had arrived at Brooklyn College in 2011, months before the AP reports were first published. And she came not as a student, but as an interested community member. She told the Muslim women students at the college that she had grown up in a secular Turkish household and was now interested in learning more about her faith. She even took the shahada, the public profession of faith, in front of her new friends. And the ISO welcomed her into the community. Some students were suspicious of her from early on, as Mel kept asking the women to tell her about jihad and suicide bombing. Her newfound interest in her faith also led to no discernible change in her behavior or actions, as would be common with new converts and people in similar situations. Nevertheless, the community members welcomed her as their personal, morals, and religious obligations dictated. Mel was thus successfully able to ingratiate herself deep into their lives. She ended up joining religious classes with some students and attended two bridal showers for ISO Muslim women, in one case bringing a large cake, probably paid for by the NYPD, to the shower that she claimed she had carried with her on the subway. She also was a bridesmaid in one ISO woman's wedding, and she continued to come to campus and find new friends, even as the members of the student club would graduate and move on. Once the arrest in Queens occurred and her identity was revealed, however, Mel completely disappeared from view. Still, the fact that the ordinary life of young Muslim women was the focus of an elaborate state security apparatus was hardly comforting to the students themselves. Quote, "The people we surround ourselves with may not actually be who they say they are." The letter R, a former friend of Mel's, told me, I'm just going to use the initials for these people who told me this, and her name is, so we'll call her R. And while the psychic toll that such mistrust brings can be hard to appreciate, R helped me understand it better. Quote, "Oftentimes we're told that if you're not doing anything wrong, there shouldn't be anything to fear," she said. "But despite not doing anything wrong, despite living a very straight, clear, clean life, I have this fear that people will take what I say out of context," she explained. After learning about Mel, R began not only suspecting those around her of being spies or informants, but that also she feared that people would start to suspect me of being an informant. Moreover, the revelation that she had been telling an undercover officer her most private thoughts had such a scarring effect on my interactions, she explained. "I began to start selecting who I would speak to and who I would allow myself to be around." She also began worrying about what kind of career she could pursue in environments where suspicion was everywhere. "And that, in so many ways," she said, "stunted all these opportunities that I could otherwise have had." Another Muslim student who interacted with Mel is S. "I wasn't particularly involved with the Islamic student organization," S told me. "Mel wasn't someone I knew well enough beforehand, but she was someone that, upon seeing a picture of her, I was like, oh my God, I've interacted with this woman before." Those interactions were in Unity meetings. Unity was basically a kind of informal group that was comprised of Black, Latino, and Muslim students, where we would talk about creating events, making sure all our schedules matched up with our calendar events, etc. It wasn't particularly remarkable in any way, but she was at three of those meetings throughout 2014. I just think about how unremarkable those meetings were and why they would warrant any surveillance. The only reason that it's possible is because that room of students is shades of brown and black, And just by virtue of that, it warrants being surveilled and warrants suspicion, because that is what people who are criminalized in this country look like. It may seem odd, or perhaps even out of proportion, to begin my brief lecture here with the story of Mel and her infiltration of the college community. The story, which nevertheless gives us some sense of what it feels like to be targeted for being Muslim, might seem small against the backdrop of a dangerous Islamophobia running amok throughout the country. While Islamophobia has long been something to grapple with in the United States even before the terrorist attacks of 2001, Muslim American life has taken a decidedly more perilous turn lately, especially since the rise of Donald Trump to the national political stage in 2015. Hate crimes against Muslims in the US in 2015 reached levels not seen since 2001. According to the FBI, and these statistics are problematic, but we could still use them for a general gauge. According to the FBI, 2015 witnessed a 67% increase in hate crime incidents against Muslims from the previous year. And in 2016, the number rose yet again, this time by almost 20% compared to 2015. The number of violent assaults, one of the worst forms of hate crimes, in 2016 also exceeded the number from 2001, previously the record high year. And in 2017, for which the final numbers are not in yet, it is also on track to being another record-breaking year. Moreover, the story of Mel would not inform us directly of a very important point, that anti-Muslim sentiment in the United States spikes, not when there is a major terrorist attack, but instead under more routine and predictable circumstances. The researcher Dalia Mugahid has clearly examined the data since 2001, and she found that public opinion concerning Muslims didn't fall precipitously after the 9/11 attacks, didn't dip after the Boston bombing, and didn't plummet after the Orlando shooting. Public sentiment has hardened against Muslims, however, at regular and identifiable moments, namely every 4 years, when the United States is embroiled in a presidential election. What this means is that Islamophobia in the United States is not merely a matter of personal opinion or private bias, but has become a political phenomenon to be exploited by our politicians. Rather than understanding Islamophobia as an irrational hatred or fear, as most phobias are understood to be, we would be far better served to consider how anti-Muslim sentiment, through this exploitation, has become institutionalized and instrumentalized over the years. And yet, ultimately, isn't the exploitation, this political exploitation, what the story of Mel illustrates? For what is spying on Muslim student groups absent any probable cause, but a clear example of precisely such instrumentalization? Here, the instrumentalization of Islamophobia into the institution of law enforcement. The constitutional protections of freedom of speech and freedom of association, along with just academic freedom, matter little when the contemporary security state can so easily override such principles. It would seem that all the state needs to do is invoke the near inevitability of terrorist actions, especially when it comes to Muslims as a group. It's almost as if law enforcement believes it knows Muslims better than they know themselves. If you think I'm exaggerating, you need only listen to the words of top law enforcement officials themselves. Testifying before the Senate Committee on Homeland Security and Governmental Affairs in 2007, Lawrence Sanchez, the CIA official who worked with the NYPD to establish its surveillance program, explained how the NYPD aimed to crawl not just into the mosques, but into the souls of Muslims to reveal their true features. Quote, rather than just protecting New York City citizens from terrorists, Sanchez said, the New York Police Department believes that part of its mission is to protect New York City citizens from turning into terrorists. From there, he argued that it was proper to trample on the constitutional rights of ordinary Muslims by explaining how the police would be investigating, quote, what most people would say would be non-criminal, would be innocuous behaviors that could easily be argued in a Western democracy, especially in the United States, are protected by First and Fourth Amendment rights. Sanchez, however, said that the police force doesn't look at these innocuous behaviors in a vacuum, but we look across them as potential precursors to terrorism. Put another way, we are now living in a time when the rights of citizenship for Muslims as a group can be, and sometimes are, abrogated for the abstract potential to be involved in the precursor of a terrorist act. And because of this potential, curtailing the rights of Muslims as a group somehow becomes legally justifiable. Along a similar logic of denying Muslim Americans the rights accorded to other Americans, the Supreme Court this past June made the disastrous decision to uphold the Trump administration's Muslim ban, which, among other things, disproportionately affects Muslim Americans in family reunification. Also in June, a new study was published that showed that nearly 1 in 5 Americans would deny Muslim Americans even the right to vote. When citizenship becomes contingent, and then contingent on behavior that is not even your own, something has gone terribly wrong. A host of interests, from outright bigotry to specific foreign policy aims, and those two things are not opposites, of course, drives both the looming contingency of contemporary Muslim American citizenship and the instrumentalization of Islamophobia in American political life. But at the bottom of both is the way that the American public and the institutions in American public life together carry certain assumptions about Islam and Muslim Americans that are not only simply wrong, but also seemingly impossible to dislodge. Muslim Americans are viewed as inherently sexist and homophobic, to use but one important example. The idea that Muslims represent a civilizational threat to the West because of an intrinsic ultra-conservatism, which includes a violent hatred of gay people, is so widespread in the US, as well as in the UK and also here in Europe, that it is seen as a truism. As I've written elsewhere, not only is this tidy bit of political wisdom false, it also ends up conveniently obscuring the degree of homophobia in other parts of our society and in our politics. In fact, while Muslim Americans are routinely seen by the American public as having outdated views on women and on gays and on lesbians, the polling data show that the differences between the American general public and American Muslims in these opinions are rather small on both counts. And Muslim Americans are significantly more progressive in their views on gays and Muslims compared to evangelical Christians, who make up a much larger portion of the American public. Muslim Americans are approximately 1%, and evangelical Christians are about 25% of the US public. Nevertheless, an inherent sexism and homophobia of the Muslim American is seen by many Americans not only as a barrier to full participation in society, but also as a prime mover, if not the prime mover, to violence. Perhaps the clearest example of this phenomenon is how the media and law enforcement officials portrayed the actions of Omar Mateen, the man who massacred 59 people in the Pulse nightclub in Orlando, Florida in 2016. I'm sure people here have heard of that and remember that terrible incident. As Huffington Post reporter Melissa Jeltson noted, pretty much everybody got Mateen's motivations for this massacre wrong. Make no mistake, Mateen committed a horrific and completely unsupportable terrorist act. But according to his own words, what drove him to his crime was not homophobia, but American foreign policy. This part of the narrative was almost completely overlooked, however. Instead, Mateen was repeatedly described as being a closeted homosexual whose sexual repression as a Muslim male led him to commit one of the worst massacres in American history. In fact, Mateen cheated on his wife with other women, had no discernible homosexual activity online or off, and most likely did not even know the nature of the club that he attacked, knowing that it was a gay nightclub. He had originally planned to attack the Disney Entertainment Complex, but when he couldn't pierce their security, he moved on to the Pulse nightclub instead. The media misreported this story completely, and they did so as Charles Swift, a lawyer for Nur Salman, Mateen's wife, said, the lawyer said, because the media depended on the government to tell it to them. The government prosecuted Nur Salman as an accomplice to Mateen's act, and only during the trial, when the government was compelled to show its evidence, did all of the information that I just revealed to you come to light. Salman, in fact, was acquitted. His wife was acquitted, a rare outcome in terrorism-related prosecutions in the United States. And yet Mateen was, and will likely still will be, considered as yet another example of the repressed and sexually frustrated Muslim terrorist feeding a highly simplistic and dangerous caricature about political violence in the world today. Contemporary Islamophobia reveals how the institutions of our society are able to inscribe their specific and often wrong narratives for Muslim behavior into the public's consciousness, and in so doing are able to justify their own problematic beliefs and actions. Oftentimes, the assumptions about Muslim Americans become ways for the rest in the country not to talk about their own homophobia or their own sexism or their own sexual repression. And institutionally, what is said about the Muslim American terrorist, future or present, enables the government to expand its power and its scope and to hide its actions from public scrutiny as much as possible. For Muslim Americans, the challenges confronting them are thus huge, beginning with the deeply problematic notion that Islam and terrorism can be equated. Today, Muslim Americans, a tiny and politically weak portion of the population, have to counteract not only powerful state-run institutions, but also a general public that seems ready and willing to curtail their rights using notions based more on rumor than on fact. In 1951, Theodore Adorno defined antisemitism as, quote, the rumor about the Jews. It doesn't matter what Jewish people believe, how they act, who they are. In other words, all that really matters, all that is of consequence, is what other people say and do about them. Islamophobia is the rumor about the Muslims. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Let's proceed to our last speaker, Jasmin Zine, Professor of Sociology, Religion, and Culture, and a Muslim Studies option at Wilfrid Laurier University. She has developed award-winning curriculum materials that address Islamophobia and anti-Muslim racism, and has worked as a consultant with the Office for Democratic Institutions and Human Rights at the Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe, the Council of Europe, and the UNESCO, on developing international guidelines for educators and policymakers on combating Islamophobia and discrimination against Muslims. She has completed a 6-year-long national study on the impact of 9/11, the war on terror, and domestic security discourses and policies on Muslim youth in Canadian universities, and is currently finishing a book manuscript based on this study. Dr. Zine is an affiliated faculty member with the Islamophobia Research and Documentation Project at Berkeley, and serves on the editorial board of the critical Muslim studies journal, Reorient. The stage is yours.
Thank you very much. It's really an honor and a privilege to be here, and I'd also like to add to the thanks and gratitude for the organizers of this conference, everyone who is involved, also for their courage and bravery to have these difficult conversations in this very fraught political moment. I think that to do this work involves having a certain amount of courage and bravery, and unfortunately a lot of the institutions we work for have abdicated that responsibility, so it's very heartening to see colleagues taking this forward. Also, thanks to my panelists, co-panelists here, who've done a beautiful job of illustrating some of the roots of securitization and how that's impacting Muslim communities in different parts of the world. Now, I come from Canada. the land of multiculturalism. Everyone thinks roses and sunshine and Justin Trudeau at the airport to give you a hug when you arrive. However, you know, as we know, multiculturalism tends to be a smokescreen that masks a lot of racism and inequality that's embedded within all of the institutions within our countries. And so it isn't that ideal, unfortunately. Sorry to shatter everyone's illusions. But what also shattered the complacency around this idea, this sort of settled notion of multiculturalism, was in January 29th, 2017, when a young white male, 23 years old, anthropology student from the University of Laval, Alexandre Bissonnette, walked into a Quebec mosque and shot dead six Muslim men while they were praying just after the evening prayers. So this was an unprecedented massacre in Canada in a house of worship, and really has called in, raised the issue of Islamophobia to a level of national debate, and in fact a level of critique, which I don't have time to get into here. But there was, of course, mourning around this tragedy, but there was also a great deal of backlash from so-called alt-right, white supremacist groups, as well as just the conservative right parties as well, on actually talking about Islamophobia and making it a matter of inquiry and action at a national and local levels. So there's always this pushback against talking about Islamophobia or naming Islamophobia. And when I talk about Islamophobia, I come as a sociologist, I understand it as a system of oppression that operates through individual ideological and systemic practices, and these work as a nexus. So if we talk about securitization and we talk about racial profiling as a systemic practice, we know that it also has individual manifestations and that it's shored up by particular kinds of ideological practices and discourses that tend to try and justify and rationalize those actions. And once it's embedded within institutional practices, it's able to be reproduced. And the ideological function of the ideological apparatus that supports it allows it to be relatively unquestioned and seen as very common sense to actually want to target Muslims for scrutiny and for surveillance. And it is also supported by an Islamophobia industry. There's a deep industry made up of individuals, groups, politicians, media outlets, those from the far right and other sectors as well, that support this industry, and it has funding from also different sectors. So there's been a sort of mapping of this industry in the United States, and I'm currently looking at mapping it within Canada, and I think we need to do this on a much larger scale to understand how Islamophobia is being pervaded and what are the sources that are supporting it from these different sectors. What I'm going to share with you today is to talk a bit about as a preface, I'm going to talk about some of the instances of securitization and how deeply it's become embedded in what's become a fairly panoptic society. But I'm also going to share with you some findings of a study that I've been doing, I'm just writing up my book on it, but looking at what I call the 9/11 generation of Muslim youth in Canada and how Islamophobia has affected them. So essentially how they're living Islamophobia and also how they're resisting it, and I think that's important. So hopefully I will have time to share some of those experiences and narratives with you. I'm supposed to move this. Okay, now this is a complex choreography with my notes and with this. I don't know if this is the right slide because I can't see it. Let me just try something here. No? Okay, must be. I wanted to start with a quote by Naomi Klein, and it just is a way of illustrating and kind of contextualizing what I'm going to be talking about. I'll read this. In just a few years, the homeland security industry, which barely existed before 9/11, has exploded to a size which is now significantly larger than either Hollywood or the music business. Yet what is more striking is how little the security boom is analyzed and discussed as an economy, as an unprecedented convergence of unchecked police powers and unchecked capitalism, a merger of the shopping mall and the secret prison. When information about who is or who is not a security threat is a product to be sold as readily as information about who buys Harry Potter books on Amazon or who has taken a Caribbean cruise and might enjoy one in Alaska, it changes the values of a culture. Not only does it create an incentive to spy, torture, and generate false information, but it creates a powerful impetus to perpetuate the sense of peril that the industry created in the first place. I think this really is a powerful way of just contextualizing how deeply embedded securitization is in our normal and daily lives on so many very deep levels. And the kind of moral panic that is necessary and required to continue to justify that security regime. So when we look at Islamophobia and the security industrial complex, which is what I'm focusing on here, in this new world order, the state, the military, and security communities, along with academics and the media, function within a security industrial complex to create new ontological categories through which Muslim youth, especially males, can be profiled, studied, policed, disciplined, and detained. Now, of course, it's not only focusing on Muslim youth or only males, but it was just drawn from the context of my research. But certainly, this is an industry that is affecting Muslims locally and globally in all sectors. And I do mention academics as part of this security industrial complex because in a separate paper, I was looking at the embedded academics who actually work with security communities and work on research that tends to reinforce these particular narratives. And how do we identify who is a radical so that we can, you know, sort out the savage from the civilized? This becomes a re-inscription of the colonial idioms of racism that is now, you know, produced in certain policies that are used by these state actors to continue to profile, discipline, and detain Muslim bodies. And so there is that area of these embedded academics who work on that, but that's a different conversation for another time. So in the making of this sort of panoptic society, I'll also quote from the ACLU, who documented the surveillance industrial complex and how the American government is conscripting businesses and individuals in the construction of a surveillance society. Through this TIPS program, Citizen Corps recruited average citizens as well as private sector workers into these watch programs. Another spin, I guess, on the neighborhood watch. Through this surveillance industrial complex, by asking them to identify and report on suspicious behavior. So now neighborhood watch families, so you know, in Canada and the US, they have these sort of neighborhood watch people within the community who are, you know, taking care of the safety of their neighborhood. But they're also being conscripted into this other sort of more nefarious kind of watch system. And they were trained on identifying suspicious behavior that could lead to terrorist activity. So now individuals and citizens are also being brought into the nexus of this security industrial complex and are being taught how to profile. So related programs included the involvement of truck drivers, real estate agents, and boaters. I guess there's a concern about radicalization at sea or something, but they talk in this report about Eagle Eyes, and this program is billed as an anti-terrorism initiative that enlists the eyes and ears of Air Force members and citizens on the war on terror. In addition to a telephone tip line, the program offers training on how to detect terrorist activity. So again, you have citizens who are being recruited into this idea of becoming profile and profiling other citizens. It is quoted there that anyone can recognize the elements of potential terror planning when they see it. That's boasted on the program's website. And the things to watch for are, quote, people who don't seem to belong. In the workplace, the neighborhood, business establishment, or anywhere else, if a person just doesn't seem like he or she belongs, there's probably a reason for that. And of course, when we start to take that understanding and connect it to racialized bodies that are always seen as somehow out of place and out of the nation, or Muslim bodies that are seen as being somehow located outside of democracy, outside of modernity, outside of civility and society, then that becomes a very large net of who and what bodies do not appear to belong and who are challenging white civility in white societies. And the report notes that public appeals are based not on crimes that have already been committed, but on the prospect or suspicion that an individual might be planning something bad. And so we're into this area of pre-crime, right? Sort of like Tom Cruise Minority Report, there was that notion of pre-crime. This is actually being enshrined and codified into security policies and regimes. In Canada as well, under Bill C-51 too, we have this. So many suspicious behaviors cited by the authorities have no rational or proven relationship to terrorism, and in fact, it's doubtful that such things are even defined, clearly defined as behavioral predictors of terrorism. We know how racism and stereotypes and Orientalism all are brought into those particular kinds of biases and who we determine to be threats to the nation, who we see as belonging, who is part of our imagined community, and who needs to be exiled from it. Predictively, these tip centers have been set up, are already attracting malicious tips from individuals turning in their neighbors that they dislike. You know, he doesn't cut his grass, so we have to turn him in. Tips about strangers engaging in un-American activity, whatever that means. And of course, many reports based on racial profiling. And so there were calls from people who might look Middle Eastern in a store or a library or using a computer, God forbid, somewhere. And so we start to see, you know, the breadth and the scope now of this kind of securitization and scrutiny that is being leveled, particularly against Muslim bodies. So that's an example from the U.S. Now, in Canada, we actually have something called the Barbaric Cultural Practices Act. So it actually is an act within Canada. And again, it's using, you know, the racial idioms of colonialism around the barbarism and savagery and so on. And then who, by extension, becomes the civilized, who is the manager, you know, the managers of multiculturalism, and who is helping to sort out those savage and civilized markers within society. So the Barbaric Cultural Practices line was brought in, it brought the Act, not the tip line, I'm going to mention that, but was brought in under the previous Harper administration. And it was meant to be an act predicated around looking at things like forced marriages, female genital mutilation, or honor killings. And, you know, it's interesting because certainly these are terrible things, but, you know, there's only been a handful of cases in Canada that could be even, you know, doubtfully included in these sorts of categories. And so we have this sort of federal, very problematically named act and policy around this. And yet, on the other hand, we have over 1,000 missing and murdered Indigenous women in our country who, you know, are the concern and the national outrage or political concern has eluded as a result. So we really need to look at the way women's bodies are being seen as dispensable while others are being policed and regulated in specific ways. We also have in Quebec, so the tip line, I was going to mention that. So it actually didn't happen, there isn't a tip line, but it was proposed that you could also call in if you were suspicious of your neighbor. I mean, and I don't know what that means, if like Fatima starts covering her face or, you know, Muhammad grows a beard, is that grounds for suspicion? So even this whole category of radicalization is never very carefully theorized or defined, and so it leaves it very open-ended, and within that allows for all of these white fears and anxieties and Orientalist fears to become inscribed. And I think that's very, very problematic, of course. And so this act also, along with the Quebec Charter of Values, previously Bill 94, sought to, has banned face veils or niqab in Quebec in public spaces. So anyone giving or receiving social services should not be wearing this. So you can understand the implications of something like that. If you are wearing the niqab, then you are denied social services. And so this is a policing and regulation of Muslim women's bodies who, as my colleagues have mentioned, comes in under this banner of a kind of civilizational danger, right? So, in Quebec, there's less than even 100 women who actually wear the niqab. But again, this has become provincial legislation and a matter of national debate. So we really need to think about, well, what is the real issue? Is it a piece of cloth, or is it what it signifies, and what is the signifier? Again, it's this foreignness, the civilizational danger, the cultural and racial pollution that Muslim women's bodies, and Muslim women's bodies are also the reproductive power that can reproduce, you know, more Muslims and therefore more threats. So while Muslim male bodies have been, you know, related to physical danger and threat against the nation, you know, as a physical and violent threat, Muslim women's bodies are part of this more civilizational danger that they represent or become emblematic, so have become this battleground upon which these particular concerns are being waged. So constructing the enemy within, this sort of making of a panoptic society. In Canada, you know, we have had concerns with homegrown terrorism. In 2006, there was an arrest of 17 youth and one adult known as the Toronto 18 who were involved with terror charges were laid against them. They actually had a religious community leader who was implanted as a mole within this group of youth who took them, you know, up north to play paintball. This was seen as a terrorist training cell. Conversations were recorded. They were, you know, talking about beheading the prime minister. There was all of this sort of evidence that was gleaned by this mole who had been implanted by the RCMP, which is the Royal Canadian Mounted Police. And so they were arrested and were charged on terrorism charges. So we've had this. We've had a shooting on Parliament Hill. So there is this sense of this homegrown threat. There's also the issue of foreign fighters, of Muslim youth in particular, males who are going abroad, but also, as Uzma pointed out, that similar concern is against Muslim females, also who are going and fighting for Daesh or ISIS abroad. There's also been the issue of the disappearing Somali youth in Canada, so Somali youth who are allegedly disappearing from their communities in places like Toronto and Minnesota in the United States, where there's a high population of Somalis, and apparently showing up in Somalia to fight with Al-Shabaab. I investigated a little bit of this in my study as well in the local community, and you know, a lot of it they thought those a lot of the youth that were gone were later accounted for. So there was also a lot of, you know, the reality, the myth, and the fact in terms of what gets exploited as being something and immediately put into these categories of jihadism and you know, threat to the nation. And you know, I don't know, they just went to a wedding actually. So there were some of these cases, and I'm not trying to be, you know, to say that no threat exists, but I think we need to be realistic about that threat and not have it be something that is now mapped onto the bodies of all Muslims and all Muslim youth. There is this collective burden of guilt and responsibility that all Muslims bear. So whenever there is an incident that you see, you know, recently there was a shooting in Toronto and every Muslim sitting there watching the screen was like, oh God, please do not let it be Muslim. And unfortunately in that instance it was. But so because we know what's going to happen, you know, and it's not the same for dominant communities, not the same for white communities. You know, when Anders Breivik killed 70, you know, youth, the next day kids named Anders were not afraid to go to school, right? It's not, and with Muslim acts of violence perpetrated by an individual or a group, it becomes mapped onto all Muslims. So the kids who go to school the next day with Muslim names are going to be harassed and bullied, right? It's going to impact you. Muslim women who wear the niqab talk about going into the subway and walking against the wall because they're afraid to be pushed onto the tracks. So this is part of the daily living of with Islamophobia, those microaggressions too, right? It's been called a, you know, death by a thousand cuts. Those ways in the day-to-day, it isn't just the big acts of violence, but it's those daily kinds of encounters that continue to push you to the fringes of society and the margins that continue to reinscribe your sense of degeneracy, racial and religious degeneracy, that are really what is part of the wounds of Islamophobia. And so, you know, these ideas of the radical, the terrorist, the extremist, and the jihadist are these new ontological categories that, about Muslim youth in particular in Canada, that constitute them as violent, degenerate fanatics hell-bent on the destruction of the West. And these kind of narrow typologies leave very little room for Muslims to be able to articulate their own sense of identity outside of these very destructive typologies. And these categories are pervaded without reference to the histories and the complex geopolitical struggles that shape these terms, without acknowledging the role of U.S. foreign policies and the war on terror in creating the conditions for reactionary ideologies to give rise to violent movements. Sorry, yes, thank you. Nonetheless, these new taxonomies of difference tell us who are to be watched, punished, exiled, for fear that they may disrupt our freedom, our values, and our nation. So the boundaries of belonging and citizenship and those separating the desirable from undesirable immigrants are anchored in these distinctions. And I call this a kind of cultural eugenics, right? Who we are deciding are desirable to have in our community and who we need to keep at bay through all the various kinds of practices that are in place. So nationhood, citizenship, civil and human rights hang in the delicate balance between the fear and moral panic generated among good citizens toward the Muslim what I call anti-citizen, and that's how Muslims have been scripted within the national narrative. So closing the degrees of separation between citizen and outsider is more than just a social or discursive shift. It's a political, legal, and ontological move. It severs the rights to have rights as a seemingly inalienable part of the citizenship franchise and includes new states of being outside the realm of the normative conditions of the rule of law within a state of exception, right? And I'm borrowing from Giorgio Gambin around this terminology. And so the security policies that we have, for example, in Canada, we have security certificates that can be issued against non-citizens who may be considered a danger, but they can be held indefinitely on secret evidence that they will not know and have secret trials against them. And so here again, the state of exception, rules of law, rules of democracy do not apply. Because we are operating, governments are now operating under this state of exception where the normative practices of statecraft are suspended and these sort of extreme measures come into place. Wow, okay. All right, enough on that. Let me move ahead. I'm going to move like quite a bit ahead, actually, because I've only got about 3 minutes. And, you know, actually, Moustafa did a beautiful job of illustrating, what happened in New York with the surveillance on Muslim student associations. I've been similarly looking at the surveillance of Muslim students in Canada. And just before I came, I got a phone call from University of Toronto Muslim Student Association, who were concerned because the RCMP, or the Royal Canadian Mounted Police, had been coming on campus wanting to talk to members of their group. This has been happening. Usually the presidents of Muslim student associations get the requisite call from CSIS, which is Canada's Security and Intelligence Service, which is our sort of spy agency. Even my son, who is he's 25 now, but when he was an undergraduate at university, in my university, he was the president of the MSA. Now, he got elected in the evening. They didn't actually send the results to the rest of the membership. They were going to do it in the morning. But before they were even announced, he got a phone call on his cell phone from CSIS, from Canada's spy agency, wanting to talk to him about matters of national security. You know, I've also had students at my university who were former presidents who were also approached by a counterterrorism unit, which is in our small town in Waterloo outside of Ontario, outside of Toronto. We have a counterterrorism, a strategic tactical unit, and they were coming on campus wanting to talk to the students as well about matters of national security. So I've sat in on these meetings. They're not happy when I'm there, actually, because they really want to get these youth on their own. I'm always concerned that they are going to try and, they're on these fact-finding missions, but we don't know how these young people aren't really prepared for this, right? But they are gaining that political literacy where they're aware of what they say and how they act and how they need to comport themselves. But my concern is also how, they can be manipulated and what they say can be manipulated. So I have sat in on some of these meetings, to provide some safety, and we are making the universities aware of this. But part of what happens with Muslim youth is an internalization of this gaze, a panopticon of self-surveillance. And this is very, very strong in the data that I had and the interviews that I did. So when I asked Muslim youth, for example, and I interviewed 130 across the country and from all different ethno-racial groups and so on, how did 9/11 affect you? Well, they'll say it didn't affect them. Say, no, it didn't really have an effect. Oh, okay. So then tell me what your student groups are doing. Well, we were going to go play paintball up north, but we decided not to do that because we didn't want to be seen as a terrorist cell, right? But 9/11 didn't affect them, all right? Or, we play these video games, Call of Duty, all of these types, in the concourse of the university, but we don't do that now. We don't want anyone to think we're plotting something or rehearsing for violence, But 9/11 didn't affect them. Right. So it's become a new normal where they didn't know a time before it. So they actually have quite assimilated these practices and they react to them. And they're quite aware of how their bodies are positioned and how they need to comport themselves and how they need to represent themselves. So the 9/11 generation has a unique ontological status, and it's a very unique and distinct a group of young people. And I found many, many interesting things that I cannot share with you about that. But I will share with you a few quotes, if I may. In this closing, do I have a couple minutes? 1 minute left? Okay.
We have time for the discussion.
Okay, all right. Well, let me just share one quote, and then I want to give you one final reflection. Okay, because I don't even know what's on the screen. Flying while Muslim. Okay, so actually, Asma covered a lot of that. I don't know where this quote is, if it's on the screen or not, but anyways, I'll read it. So this is one of my participants who said, and going back to this flying while Muslim, right, is that when we were going to the U.S., I was with my baby cousin, and he was in the airplane, and he had a book written for children about how to fly an airplane. And then we were also scared. We're like, why did we pack this? Like a children's book for a Muslim kid on how to fly an airplane. They're like, oh my God, who packed this book, right? And everyone was scared because you're always on the lookout. Are we going to be judged? Should I probably sit more nicely? Should I smile more? People shouldn't be scared of me. So this is the internalization of that gaze and how it causes a lot of these youth to consider how their bodies are resonating within these spaces. So they become very politicized at a young age around this. And so this need to kind of monitor their bodies and how they are acting, and I don't want anyone to be suspicious. Maybe I shouldn't wear black. I don't seem approachable. So all of these kinds of things. I need to end with one thing. So please indulge me one thing, because this, to me, is very important, that we don't end on this note of Muslims as victims, right? And I'm very heartened by youth who are using, in particular, I've been looking at youth who are using the arts as a form of political resistance and agency to react against this securitized society and Islamophobia and everything that they are being challenged with. And they're using it to build on the productive tensions that exist. I want to give you one example because I think it's pertinent. I interviewed a woman who is Palestinian, Canadian, and she was in a theater company in the U.S. and she met an Israeli colleague in the theater company. And they do physical comedy. And they went out together one day, they had coffee, and they, were having the difficult conversation, trying to talk about Israel-Palestine, trying to talk about how they were both positioned within this and had deeply held beliefs. And they started to talk about, how oppressed people can be complicit in the oppression of others. And they got into a heated fight in a restaurant. And they were actually like kicked out of the restaurant. People, were looking. And so when they got out, they actually started laughing and they said, what are we doing? Why are we doing this? We need to actually start to unpack some of these issues and we need to, have some critical conversations. So they used comedy as a way and used theater as a way to open up those conversations. They started a troupe called Comedy Relief. And it's an Israeli and Palestinian comedy troupe, and they do sketch comedy to try and interrogate these very difficult conversations that we need to have. But they use comedy as a means of disarming and of inviting people into these dialogues. And afterwards, they go into the audience and they have a facilitation, so this really great form of critical public pedagogy. So I'm very, if I find hope and resilience, it's within these young people who are taking the stage, who are taking the mic, who are taking over and are using the arts and other ways, using their voices to resist and to find ways to have these difficult conversations and to, think and imagine alternative futures that can exist. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much for your contributions, Professor Bayoumi, Dr. Jamil, and Professor Zine. You've covered a really wide range of aspects and very vividly showed us what securitization means in the U.S. and in the Canadian context. And I think for a lot of us, this also resonates in the German context, the French context, the European context. And I'm happy to see how we can further discuss this. I would like to just say that we would like to hold the discussion in two blocks. So I will just start with a question on clarifying what securitization means, and then Zakariya will continue with conclusions on how securitization actually bears upon the lives of Muslims on a daily level. So I will just start with my threefold question. Yes, so as I said, you've actually given us a range of examples of how securitization plays out in a post 9/11 context. And just to go a little step back and to understand what is the specific significance of 9/11, as you've also highlighted, Professor Zine, I would like to know if you see a specific difference or shift between the pre 9/11 securitization discourses and the post 9/11 securitization discourses. maybe also with a specific focus on gender or sexualization aspects as well. You've mentioned Orientalism as a trope, etc., so maybe just go a little into that. And also, I would like to understand, well, in the German-speaking context, people like Kurayi Maraskunay and Jin Haritawan have, I think it was around 2012, highlighted how homophobia, sexism, also anti-Semitism get externalized onto the Muslim subject. And so our societies have nothing to do with it. I think Professor Yenaralu also pointed to this. And also, yeah, so we have also this this thing called Muslim anti-Semitism, for example. And I was just wondering, how do these different forms of discrimination and oppression get projected onto the Muslim body, and how are they used in a sense of securitization? How are Muslim citizens as well as non-citizens portrayed as a threat with everything, with their culture, with their religion, with everything that they bring with them to Europe especially? Yeah. Maybe one of you could start.
Yeah. Okay, let me begin. I'm not sure I followed exactly what you were asking for in the last question, but maybe in my rambling I'll cover it, inshallah. Okay. Let me begin by saying, and I think in the last question too, maybe I can address from the previous panel too. But let me begin by talking about the differences, at least in the United States context, between pre-9/11 and post-9/11 situations, especially when it comes to Islamophobic and anti-Muslim sentiments and actions. So definitely there has long been an active notion of, you know, an Islamophobia slash Orientalist way of running the U.S. state, and that has a lot to do with American foreign policy. If that hadn't been the case, then someone like Edward Said, for example, could not have written Covering Islam, which, you know, was written back came out in 1980 or 81, and so far before 9/11, obviously. And up until 9/11, in the United States, one of the things that was an important legal case were a handful of cases of people, mostly immigrants, mostly Palestinian immigrants, who were prosecuted on the basis of what was called secret evidence at the time. And so these were cases of people who were prosecuted in immigration court and not in criminal court, because the standards for evidence are much lower in immigration court than in criminal court, and they don't have a right to an attorney in immigration court. They can get one, but the state does not have to provide one, and things like that. And so there were a handful of people who were being prosecuted, and many of them were activists. This also relates back to what was called the LA 8 case, which is a series of Palestinian activists who had also been prosecuted by the state for membership in a Marxist organization, actually. That goes back to the McCarthy era. So you have all of this history that happens prior to 9/11, very specifically targeted to specific people within particularly activist circles, particularly dealing with situations that are happening overseas. Right. After 9/11, things, I think, do change. They change in terms of scale, obviously. The amount of repression goes through the roof, state repression. So scale changes. Also, the imagination, the American imagination around Islam and Muslims, I think, changes. Not in the general sense, there's a continuity of Orientalism from pre-9/11 to post-9/11, but now in the sense that the danger is living among us. That notion, I think, was far less pronounced prior to 9/11. It was most things were oriented to overseas situations. And so suddenly now it became this idea of who are these, began mostly, who are these Arabs and Muslims? And now we just talk about Muslims. But there was this time in the United States when there was a phrase, Arabs and Muslims, as if it was just one word, right? And it's still there to some degree. And so it affected also then a lot of people who were living in the United States who had no relationship to politics, namely, people of Muslim
look, belief, value, what have you. So they then became also subject to a lot of different elements of the American state security apparatus. So I think it's important to understand the differences in terms of policy, in terms of imagination, in terms of geography. So I think all of those changed from pre-9/11 to post-9/11. In terms of the second question around Muslim anti-Semitism, I mean, yes, Muslim anti-Semitism exists. It's also true that the boogeyman of Muslim anti-Semitism can also be marshaled in a kind of Islamophobic gesture to label all Muslims as anti-Semitic. And that, I think, often happens, especially when we end up talking about the Israel-Palestine debate, which I think relates back to the question from the last session. And so, you know, I mean, I would be very wary of that move. You know, I think we have to analyze that move of how debate gets shut down when we're talking about Israel-Palestine by allegations and accusations of anti-Semitism, because there's an equation between being anti-Zionist equals being anti-Semitic, which I think that equation does not hold. Maybe in some cases, there might be the case, but not as a general principle, I think that doesn't hold. I'm not the only one to think this. You can read Judith Butler on this. You can read a whole host of other people who've written on this issue. You can go back to Albert Einstein and Hannah Arendt, who were critical of Zionism from the very beginning. You know, so I think that we have to look at the rhetorical moves that are used to actually shut down and silence debate. So that's an important element. And it's also important then to understand the ways in which, that debate also occludes the representation and the voices of certain people, right? And so, for example, my mentor, I was fortunate enough to study, you know, with Edward Said. And so one of his very famous essays is, of course, Zionism from the standpoint of its victims. And so, you know, we have to acknowledge that Zionism has produced certain victims as well. And I think, actually, if we look at the Jerusalem exhibit in this very museum right now, I would encourage everybody to go. I went and looked at it. I think it's a really interesting exhibit. It's represented there, too. And so I think it's very important to understand, you know, the complexity of our human situations and to acknowledge within that complexity that we have to address all kinds of issues. And when we start shutting down debate by accusations, what we're doing is limiting our ability to solve any kind of issue in the future. And so does that answer your question? Okay, good, thank you.
Dr. Jamil or Dr. Zine, would you like to say something to that question?
So I think Moustafa covered a lot of stuff. Maybe a few comments to the first point about pre and post. So I feel the need to stake out the difference between Canada and the US here. Pre and post 9/11, I think because America was subject to the attack, the national imaginary around Muslims was very distinctive in the US. I think Canada, even though there's a lot of sort of bleeding through of a lot of these national imaginaries, the sense of threat was not actually triggered so much by the attacks in the US, but with the quote unquote what's called the homegrown terrorism case, the Toronto 18, a number of years later, where a group of young Muslim men were considered, it's the case that she referred to, we're talking about a so-called sleeper cell in Toronto. So this idea where that the threat was a sort of an everyday threat, it was internal to the nation, that it was related to terrorism, much less than this idea that the potential for terrorism was there. So I mean, the World Trade Center attacks are very, very clearly, you know, an event that was a terrorist event. So I think there's a distinction there in terms of what are the ways in which the national imaginary becomes activated, what kind of figures activate this particular kind of thing. And I think also to make a distinction then the ways in which, as he said, the way violence is understood as existing within the nation versus outside the nation. So a lot of the violence in the past was this idea that it was embedded within diasporic communities of quote-unquote Muslim immigrants, as Maida mentioned yesterday, which is a problematic term. So in national communities, Palestinians, Iranians, whatever that may be, that violence existed and they brought it in with them to Canada, and so therefore they need, you know, that was sort of an issue, as opposed to the fact where the violence or the potential for violence was already in Canada in the first place, and then therefore how do we deal with that?
Yes, to add to these comments, I think in terms of the pre and post 9/11 in Canada, and Usma's sort of given us a good context for understanding that. I was researching Muslims prior to 9/11 and in Canada, and I think the questions at that time that we were asking and looking at weren't quite around securitization. It wasn't as heightened a phenomenon. And in fact, the literature in Canada about Muslim communities had a lot more to do with families, had a lot more to do with sort of the history of the presence of Muslims in Canada. There's a marked shift after 9/11 where academic research began to shift towards looking at securitization, looking at Islamophobia, looking at the impact of Muslim communities. So we weren't as focused on the securitization aspect then. But what I will say too, or what I wanted to comment about is, you know, this idea of also researching Muslims and as researchers, how have these politics affected us? How has Islamophobia and securitization affected the work we do? And I think it has in very, you know, profound ways in terms of those of us who are ethnographers or doing interviews, you know, we normally have this contract with our participants. There's a form that they sign. We have ethical protocols. We offer them anonymity and privacy and that we will be holding their data, their interviews and information they give us with securely. But in a climate of securitization, what happens if the RCMP knock on your door and want access to somebody you've interviewed, or if CSIS comes to your door and wants access to your files? To what extent can we still promise anonymity and safety and security? So when I was doing my study, which was post 9/11, we started to, you know, out of an abundance of caution, separate things from the data, not put full names on transcripts. If we had full names, they were kept separate and kept paper copies, I guess, if we had to eat them if someone came to the door. But we kept all of this separately coded with numbers, and so that it wouldn't be easy to figure out who was who. None of the forms were kept in one place, these sorts of things that we did, just that we weren't doing prior to 9/11. But we've also had to consider, you know, how securitization affects research and the work that we do and our what we can actually promise to maintain the integrity of the information that we receive from our participants, and the offer of privacy now becomes contingent upon this political securitized landscape. So that's one thing that has changed. Just in terms of the issue, the second question that was asked and that was asked in the previous session around, you know, the equation of critiquing Zionism as being a form of anti-Semitism, I found some of the strongest allies on critiquing, you know, sort of issues around occupation and political Zionism have come from Jewish communities. At least in Canada, we have Jewish Voices of Peace. We have Jews Against the Occupation, Women in Black, other organizations that are also very critical. And so are they also anti-Semitic? I mean, I think that we have to be careful how these terms get leveled to silence and stifle debate. And I brought the issue of these youth, you know, Israeli-Palestinian youth coming together, having these entrenched positions, having these prejudices. Actually, they talk about having the hatred for one another and how they managed to work against that and how they managed to have critical dialogues that shifted their perspective so that they could then become allies and they could work in a broader forum to challenge these kinds of embedded hatreds and inequalities and be very honest with each other, you know, and be very honest in having to deal with the burden of looking at, you know, your own communities through a critical lens, whether it was, you know, on both sides. And I think that that takes courage. Again, it goes back to that. And I think that we are at a historical time and moment where we also have to exercise that courage and honesty. So.
So as time is running, I'm going to jump in with my question and then collect some other questions. Given the title of the conference, Living with Islamophobia, I was wondering in how far studies on Islamophobia do take into account how different experiences with Islamophobia can be. I'm thinking about, when we talk about intersectionality, I'm thinking about the experience of specific experiences of queer Muslims, of trans Muslims, but also when anti-black racism and anti-Muslim racism come together. So what is the specific experience then of black Muslim women with hijab, for instance. So let us put like some more complexity in this living with Islamophobia, because I guess there is not this one way of living or experiencing, even if there are similarities. So what is happening there if other categories come into play in this intersection of race, gender, sexuality? We could even add more. And let's, I would say we collect 3 to 4 and then questions from the audience. We would collect first, and then over there.
I think
there. Yes, there's one person in the third row.
My name is Mariam Ahmed. I work for Robert Bosch Foundation. My question is, and I'm very thankful to Jasmin that you mentioned microaggressions and how it feels to be affected by that. My question is, how does it feel to grow up in an environment which is totally constructed and structured Islamophobic? What does that have, what kind of psychological effects does that have on the persons affected? Especially what kind of mental stress this releases? And as you have shown, the perceptions are internalized, some deal with that by self-surveillance and reducing their mobility and their chances, especially in the case of the spies, that has led to mistrust and anxiety. And this is my question. What kind of psychological effects does that have?
Thank you. Let's collect some more over here. Oh, there it was. Sorry. And then here.
Hi. Thank you very much, also from my side. I have a question because it's sort of like, I think, combines quite a few of the things that were touched upon. So on one hand, thank you so much for bringing up the issue of Muslim anti-Semitism, which is debated quite a lot, especially in this country. And I wondered, because one of the things that's not discussed so much is Jewish anti-Muslim racism, which also plays into the whole issue. And you talked about the issue of bringing Jews or Israelis in that sense and Palestinians together. The problem is, and I wondered, I think coming from a German, Turkish, Jewish background myself and being extremely an advocate for, against anti-Muslim racism, therefore also being, and that sort of stretches in the security issue of being marked, what many Muslim people are being marked, good Muslim, bad Muslim, good Jew, bad Jew. And what I heard, I think it was in the States, if I'm not mistaken, that the security or surveillance machine went into Jews who are against the occupation or who are against Islamophobia, and that security was stretched. In, I think in Germany it's still a little bit different. In that sense, you don't get persecuted to such level, but you're still marked or being not invited to certain panels or jobs, etc. So I wondered if you're against the, let's say, white supremacist status quo, how do you, if you want to build coalitions, how do you do that? Because that sounded a little bit too romanticized, in my opinion, from a very practical perspective.
Thank you. And now, here to the front, in the second row. Yes.
Hi, my name is Fatima Sayed, and I'm studying political science at the Free University of Berlin. And I was wondering how to make sense of the state support of Islamophobia or anti-Muslim racism despite its harming to social cohesion and national unity.
Let's add one more, I think. Okay, if there's one left, there behind, at the back.
Hi, my name is Saad Malik, and actually my question goes in that direction, Ozan, that you, your question is going in terms of intersectionality to the excellent speakers. What do your findings show, your research show, with people who are identifying as Muslims, let's say me as a Muslim man who might look to others as Muslims, but I understand over the course of my lifetime now how to navigate in certain situations, let's say racial profiling, to bring intersectionality, for example, bring my queerness into that situation to navigate myself out of the threat that I experience. But what does it do in the end to my Muslim identity? And how? What kind of role do I play to my Muslim community when I learn to navigate in a way through these situations where I neglect my Muslim identity, maybe for me or for my family or from whomever, it feels like that I do refuse to be Muslim in that moment, and how much, you know, what's the psychological effect on an individual and community level of that?
Thank you. So, who wants to start answering the questions?
No, I don't know.
How long do we have? Yeah. Only because all those questions are so rich and can easily, you know, take up another session. Let me quickly give you some random thoughts one more time. Starting with the question around why would states involve themselves with practices that will harm their social cohesion? Well, I think that's what, that's what our states do, and especially in moments of populism right now. I mean, you can gain a lot of political support. You might lose the 1% of the Muslim population, but that 1% is immaterial to you. It doesn't matter. You can gain so much more by demonizing this group. And we're in the moment now when politicians don't even use the language of unity, national unity anymore, at least not in the United States. Like, Donald Trump does not run on an idea that he is good for all Americans. Donald Trump runs explicitly by saying, I think this group of Americans is better than this group of Americans, quite explicitly. His politics is not one that's oriented around social cohesion. So there's much political gain to be had. And of course, what happens there too is, and the reason, the very fundamental reason why we are all here is that it's not about the Muslims. It's about what happens when, after the Muslims, who else is next? And then who's next after that? And what does that do to the notion of us all living together anyways? And there are examples of that in the past that we know about. If the fact that Muslims, let's pretend Muslims didn't exist. If Muslims didn't exist, Islamophobia would have invented them, if you know what I mean. Or some kind of bigotry would have invented the notion of Islam and Muslims in order to justify its own behaviors, in a sense. Jean-Paul Sartre says something very similar to that in his book, Antisemitism and Jew, Antisemitism and the Jew, yes. With regards to the last question around identity issues and the complexity of trying to negotiate between, you know, different sides of one's self and what that means within a society. I mean, frankly, I think all of us have a lot of those complications and complicated notions of self. What's different is that with Muslim communities, they're under a political microscope, right? And so everything gets magnified to this extraordinary degree. And so how do you live within that magnification, right? And I think one of the ways to resolve that problem is, first of all, to stop thinking about the Muslim community. We have to, you know, I'm sure it's no revelation to people here that there are thousands of different types of Muslim communities, even within Germany. I'm certain of it, right? Certainly that's true within the United States. There are many different versions of what being Muslim actually means. And I feel like the rhetoric in this
conference so far, although very elevated and very interesting, has sometimes talked about the Muslims or Muslim the Muslim communities, this or the Muslim communities that. I'm probably guilty of it myself. But I think it's very important to understand that there are multiple Muslim communities. So one doesn't have to seek approval from one only one Muslim community. One can seek approval, one can create Muslim communities at the same time. And in fact, that's where social change and social movements are born, is in that creation. And so I feel like this is an opportunity, frankly, to recreate the kind of society that we want, that we all want to live in. This is what happens when we live in these great moments of political pressure. Are we going to shift our society in this direction, or are we going to shift our society in that direction as a collective? Which gets me back to a question about young people and growing up a Muslim American or Muslim minority as a young person at this moment. I mean, I actually wrote a book about this called How Does It Feel to Be a Problem? I think that one of the interesting outcomes that you see is that young Muslim Americans have generally embraced their Muslimness rather than having run away from it, right? Acknowledging that when I say that, I'm talking about various kinds of Muslimness, right? Just because I don't want to contradict what I just said. And in fact, what for all kinds of reasons, they've embraced their Muslimness because they want to find out how to answer questions, for example. Like a lot of people come to, what is it, why do you wear hijab? What is Sharia? Those are the innocent questions, right? And then there's like the non-innocent questions. And if you're 16, 17, 18, 19, you have no idea how to answer those questions. You go to other people who have had those questions asked you. Muslim student associations, as an example, have grown in size since 2001. In the United States. And people have generally adopted the identity. They want to take on the mantle because they want to be able to in fact, define themselves rather than be defined by the hostile culture that is outside of them. And so what that means is that there's actually been a lot more activism also on the ground by young Muslim Americans in the United States than there had been prior to 2001. And that's where you see also the progressive shift of the Muslim American community as a whole that you can find in things like the Pew survey that was cited in my talk and earlier as well. And you can find in a way, it's because the Muslim American community exists under such pressure that the Muslim American community is, with others, actively creating a kind of vision of what kind of society they and we all want to live in. You know, it's the polling data will show you that something like 50% or more of Americans have negative opinions about Muslims. Now, you can look at that and say, oh my God, right? But you can also say, okay, that means almost 50% have positive opinions. You know, it's a glass half full, half empty, right? And so at that point, there are other people that you can and often do and will make common cause with. And I'll give you one final example. And I guess I can't answer all the questions because I'm going to go on too long. But here's my final example, is when there was the spying situation that I was describing in my paper today, when that came to light, you know, was the same time in New York City when there was a lot of pressure on the New York City Police Department for what was called the stop and frisk policy. And stop and frisk was where the police would basically stop people randomly on the street. And then if they thought that there was like furtive behavior or they weren't looking at the policeman right or what have you, and then they would actually go into their pockets and frisk them, and maybe they had a little bit of marijuana or something, and it would lead to a lot of arrests, as well as just basic daily humiliation. And it should be no surprise that stop and frisk attacked mostly poor Black and Latino communities in the United States, or in New York City, because this is a municipal concern with the police. And stop and frisk was hundreds and hundreds of thousands of cases like this per year. So it was actually people in these communities felt like they lived often under what was the equivalent of a military occupation in a lot of ways, right? And humiliated every day. So there was a police reform movement that was quite powerfully gaining some traction in New York City at the time. And then there was these revelations about the NYPD that was coming out at the same time. Those two communities and multiple other communities all united in New York City to oppose what the NYPD was doing, because they saw that their concerns were common. They saw that they wanted to have a more ethical policing standard, at the very least, in New York City. So it was not the anti-Muslim spying campaign in New York City that was led, and that ultimately created a brand new office of the Inspector General, who will oversee the actions of the police department. That was the culmination of efforts by many different groups, not by Muslim community groups alone. And the Muslim community groups joined a full force and happily to also with the other police reform movements that had nothing to do, but were not directly related to Muslim concerns the way that Muslim spying had been. In other words, we see a lot of that cross-pollination in the activist world in the United States right now. And you might not see it from a distance, because you just tend to see, I think, from a distance, details disappear. But in all of the horrible things that we have in our political landscape in the United States, it's producing new kinds of alliances that are absolutely necessary if we're going to move forward. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm just going to respond very briefly to the question about the social cohesion and state practices. I would say that actually state practices have always revolved around creating a nation that includes some and excludes others. It's just that the groups that are excluded have changed over time. So this is nothing new, what we're going through now. I mean, in North American context, in Canada, you know, it was the indigenous who were excluded in the creation of the nation in the first instance. The idea of a white nation in Canada, white nation policies in Canada, US, Australia, a number of other countries excluded people of color, racialized migrants, and saying the country was for white people, very explicitly. So this idea, I think, is that there is a choice between state practices that would not be create, you know, would not undermine social cohesion, and there are those that would. In fact, I think there is no distinction at all. They simply do. That's it.
Thanks. Thank you for really great questions. Yes. Thanks for the great questions. I want to respond to the comment that you had around how do we create solidarities in the midst of a lot of political tensions. And I wasn't trying to romanticize, actually far from it, but we do need to look at examples of what people are doing. And I'm interested in this space of what I call a subaltern Muslim counterpublic. Right? And I'm very interested in how youth are engaging in that space. And so, you know, that example comes, and it's a limited one, and I'm not saying that, okay, just do theater and now all of the problems will be solved. Okay, I'm not making these kinds of facile equations, right? Although it's interesting because in Canada, the government has done things like that. And their way of doing countering violent extremism is in these covert ways, where they will fund a youth program, right, to say, well, let's get them civically engaged so they don't blow up the parliament buildings, right? So, oh, just do some spoken word, and it's like, okay, I'll do this, and then I won't blow up the building. It's like really crazy kinds of strategies that the state uses to sort of, you know, de-radicalization, which is, so CVE is taking many different forms. So when you talk about political alliances and solidarities and how we work together across communities of difference, I think that that's an ongoing challenge and struggle. I don't have a formula for it. I know that it organically comes together in different places. This summer I was in Spain talking about Islamophobia quite a bit, and even with Roma Muslims, right? And they're all struggling to create spaces of alliance with others, with, you know, Moroccans in Spain, with others, and, you know, and across communities of other kinds of sexual difference or LGBTQ Muslims. I remember, you know, during anti-war coalition, during the war in Iraq, around the table, we had the most fantastic coalition, that people who just showed up, who were Buddhists, who were Jewish groups, who were, you know, an LGBT group who had a fabulous name called Glamorous Outrage. We had, you know, every kind of, you know, we had Muslims. Muslims were actually a small group at that table. So I think a lot of these community coalitions come together, and sometimes it's on strategic basis. Sometimes you can agree on this platform, so you come together, but you may disband and disagree on other platforms. Sometimes it's a strategic form of engagement, and that's the reality, right? So you may not see eye to eye on everything, but there are spaces of engagement that I think can be forged, you know, and are necessary to do so. I think what's happening is now a real fragmentation of the left, and again, the surge of right-wing populism. And we can't afford to be asleep at the wheel. We can't afford to be divisive around our politics, because we've already seen what can unfold. And we're seeing that globally, right? So I think the stakes are very, very high, and we have to work towards any form of a cohesion around people of conscience who want to come together under these platforms. So I'm really not trying to be romantic, but I am trying to reserve a space for hope and for resilience, which, by the way, is another term that the state CVE has co-opted to try and create resilience among, like, Muslim youth. So they have co-opted that. In other words, that they're predisposed to being radical, and how do we make them more resilient to ward that off, right? But we need to reclaim this notion of resilience. And I see it again. I do studies on youth, so I see how youth are able to become, to create that resilience because they are politicized at a young age. And this is getting back to the issues of trauma that you were talking about in terms of, well, how is Islamophobia affecting, what does it look like on the ground? How is it affecting bodies and spirit? What is this spirit injury that happens when we are affected by racism is trauma, colonialism is trauma, Islamophobia is trauma, and it affects people on that level. And we don't have the resources to deal with that. You know, the sort of Western medical model, and allopathic forms of dealing with things, and the ways of looking at even questions around mental health and wellness when it comes to being culturally responsive, it's not there at all, at least in our context in Canada. And so I think that, you know, we need to have resources to help deal with the kind of psychological effects and trauma. On a sort of sociological level, what I did find in my study of the 9/11 generation is one of the things they do is a kind of either an investment in Islamic identity, like this happened, we're under siege, so we're gonna, you know, even invest more in this identity, and we're going to, you know, really inhabit it and claim it, or there's an estrangement. You know, so there's the investment or the estrangement of, well, you know, I don't really want to keep some social distance. I might change my name. You know, I don't want to necessarily be, you know, or I'll be, you know, selectively involved with that. And so that is one of the things that happens, right, in terms of how this generation of youth are actually trying to manage and negotiate and navigate their identity within this context. Let me see if I had anything else. Okay, one other, like in conclusion, I'll just share one thing. In terms of, again, the pre-9/11 and post-9/11, in sort of the preface of my book, I was remembering when I was in the Muslim Student Association some 30 years ago, and we did this fundraiser, which we try and picture this now. We were raising money for a group that since has been on a terrorist watch list called Human Concern International. They were raising money for Afghanistan, which at the time was under Russian occupation. And so in Canada, we had a lot of Mujahideen fighters who were coming for rehabilitation. They'd been injured, landmines, and they lived next door to where I lived. So when we were doing this big fundraiser, we decided to have them come and be security. And we held the fundraiser in a Catholic school base auditorium. So outside this Catholic school, we had these men walking with, you know, like these long kurtas and turbans and walkie-talkies, walking around the school, right, as our security. And, you know, and we were raising for this organization that years later ended up being now, you can't talk about them, you know, because they're on the terrorist watch list. So trying to imagine this happening now, where someone tried to, you know, convene a situation like that is completely different. So this is, you know, an example of the pre and post 9/11, where you would not even think or imagine such a possibility. So it really has been a challenge to the imaginary and to how do we then imagine our way out and think of alternative futures. I think it's a critical question to consider.
Thank you. Yes, thank you very much to all of our panelists for a very invigorating debate, and I hope we can continue over lunch. Just before we continue, Leontine Meyer van Mensch would like to also make an announcement, and I think I would just like to echo that also all three of you have spoken about the potential for transformation in the political and in raising political awareness and discussing critical questions. So I hope we will continue with that. Ms. van Mensch, please.
Wow, thank you so much. I'm very energetic here with lots of ideas. I don't want to interrupt you from your lunch. I just want to say that I want to follow up what is being said on the panel. Everybody who's interested in seeing the Jerusalem exhibition or go downstairs and watch the Liebeskind architecture is absolutely free to do so. Let's use this sticker as an alternative entry ticket. And if our friendly hosts are bothering you, say, Leontine allowed it. And I hope that is a way of entering. And I'm, of course, very interested in your reflections, especially on the Jerusalem exhibition, because I think there's a lot of collective wisdom in this crowd that can, for us, interestingly, reflect upon Jerusalem and the issues addressed. If you don't want to waste your luncheon by going into the exhibition, I understand. But we are open till 8 o'clock this evening. Until 8 o'clock this evening, let's use the badge, the sticker, to get in if you're interested. And if you're not interested, that's also okay. Okay, thank you so much.